The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Mullins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Wednesday, February 2nd, 2022. I'm Kevin Larame, joined by Duane Rollins. Duane, it is match day 3 of this window, match day 11 of the Concacaf Road to Qatar 2022. Today, Canada-El Salvador this evening. We'll break down Canada-El Salvador, the matchup. We'll look at the best players on both teams. We'll also look at the starting 11 those teams showed in this window and what we can expect tonight. Honduras is playing the USA. Mexico also will break down CONCACAF's World Cup qualifying this evening. But Duane, how are you today?
Doing pretty well. The Olympics also sort of started today, not the ceremonies. So, you know, me and the Olympics and five rings and all that sort of stuff. Excited about that. So, but we got more important things first. You know, I can put the curling on the shelf for a few days and focus on Canada v. El Salvador. And come on,
you go. You can put the curling on ice, you mean? Like, put the curling on ice for a bit, and we'll talk about it later. Of course, Five Ring Podcast, you can subscribe. We have three podcasts going on SPN right now. Soccer Today every day. Five Rings will be going daily or very close to daily during the Olympics. And Betting on Sports Podcast, which is talking about college basketball and NFL football lately, which you can subscribe to the newsletter too. You can follow Duane on Twitter at 24th Minute, myself at Kev Larame, and this show is available everywhere you get your podcasts. Today, Canada is traveling to El Salvador. Some reinforcements. Zachary Brogiard is on the way. We've talked about it. Let's look at the overview of this evening. I guess the schedule of this evening. Four games in CONCACAF. It starts at 7 p.m. Jamaica hosts Costa Rica. This is a fascinating game for Jamaica. If they get a win, Costa Rica is under pressure. If Costa Rica gets a win, they put Panama under pressure for the last window. We'll look at the table later. USA-Honduras is a game you want to really pay attention to. If you are a Canadian fan, Honduras could play spoilers. And if Honduras wins, there's a scenario out there that sees Canada qualify for the World Cup tonight. El Salvador hosts Canada, and Mexico hosts Panama at the Estadio Azteca. This one is your nightcap at 10 p.m. That is your schedule for the last evening of CONCACAF play in this window, Dwayne.
Yeah, banana peel comes to mind when it comes to the Canada game, as we're all start with that. If you don't know, get my reference there. What I mean is it could be a slip up that you're unexpecting, because this is the one that maybe they've relaxed a bit after the big USA game. I mean, as much as we like to maybe pretend otherwise, there always is a little bit more at stake, a little bit more emotional stake into a USA game. Now that that's over, can they recover that? Now, I'm trying to find ways to remain skeptical about this game, because it seems like you should have an element of doubt always there. And I'm sure maybe the players and the John Herman and the coaching staff have said this as well. But, you know, this is also a team that has always found a way to motivate themselves. And I'm sure that they're going to say this is another way to another time to prove that we can be, you know, successful in Central America and all that good stuff. But for sure, if you get the 3 points tonight, then you're on 25. You're above the magic number everyone said that was going to be the qualifying number, even if it's not mathematically done at that point, which it does require an upset that doesn't seem likely to happen. But even if that doesn't happen, it's done. It's done already, probably, but it's really, really done if they get three more points tonight, Kevin.
Yeah, and we can look at the table as we set the table for tonight. Canada top of that table with 22 points. We have the U.S. second in that table with 18. Mexico tied on points, but third because of differential for Mexico. Panama is on the bubble, or more precisely, more accurately, on the half spot. If Panama finishes fourth, whoever finishes fourth will play the one-game play-in spot a week before the World Cup in Qatar against the representative from Oceania, which it's a very high likelihood that it will be New Zealand. Costa Rica is fifth, El Salvador, Canada's opponent this evening, is sixth. They just climbed one spot. They started this window at the seventh spot, and they now are sixth, and with a win tonight, could put Costa Rica under pressure. But, you know, you would need a few different scenarios for El Salvador to climb all the way to fourth. there's still a big gap between El Salvador and Panama. But El Salvador, we shouldn't take them too lightly. They have kept the States at a 1-0 victor. 1-0 result, I mean, last week. We can even look at the result of that game last week and their lineup in a second. It was a surprising result for the States, only a 1-0 win against El Salvador, which tells me that El Salvador is not going to lay down tonight.
Well, I mean, simple hashtag math tells me that El Salvador can be eliminated outright tonight if Panama were to get an upset or even to get a point against Mexico. And then El Salvador were to not get a win. I guess a point would technically keep them in, but when you look at the goal differential, it would be unlikely, right? They'd have to overcome 7 goals in the last 3 games if that were the case with the draw and the loss scenario. If it's a loss and 3 points for Panama, which, again, you don't think is going to happen, but if it were to happen, then they're out. So they have to play. They have to play hungry. And you know, Jonathan said this on the show yesterday, Jonathan Tannenwald. You can listen to yesterday's show in the archives, that he felt there were 3 teams in this group of qualifying that were playing up to expectation. One of those teams was El Salvador. They're going to come out scrappy. They're going to come out hard. They're going to play to the top end of their ability. Now, Canada has the top end talent to beat this team. They don't have a player on their roster like Jonathan David that can play, do stuff that they can do. They don't have a player like Tejan Buchanan out there.
No.
These are both players that played a lot of minutes in this window. So we'll see whether, they go the full 90 tonight or whether they need to, but I suspect they hope they don't have to use them for full 90, but they're there if they need them. And look, talent says that Canada should win this game. Results say that Canada should win this game. The betting markets say that Canada should win this game.
So we should be careful.
Yeah.
But just jokes aside, when we look at the potential starting 11 for tonight, and what you see on your screen is Canada starting 11 against Honduras on the 27th in San Pedro Sula. And I think we're going to have a similar starting 11. You might actually have more rotation. I don't expect Samuel Piet to play. He actually got a little bit of a knock in that game. It's not that serious. We'll see if he actually will get minutes tonight. But I am expecting a closer to this lineup. I do expect a 3-4-3 type of formation. I do expect an Atiba Hutchinson to have a pretty big role to play tonight. And I do feel this is going to be a lineup similar to the game against Honduras last week. This being the third game of the window and the last game until March for the Canadian men's national team, there's not too much at stake. You can maybe use players a bit more than last game. You have less to lose tonight. So I feel we might see players like Jonathan David start with a Kyle Aaron also, probably. We'll see if it's a junior let. We'll see if Tejan Buchanan starts up top or how they set it all up. But I wouldn't be surprised to see Canada's top starting 11, maybe the earlier substitutions, if the scoreline permits it.
The sub that will need to be made from the Honduras lineup, we Steven Victoria, has a yellow card suspension. So he will not be available for the game tonight. So you would expect Daniel Henry will step into that role. And look, this is probably a good place for Daniel to play. He has a little out of season right now. He's sort of training with Salt Lake, hasn't been in Korea for a while. So you don't want to stretch him too hard, but this is an opportunity for him to get some legs in there. So, you know, there are some challenges tonight. And Steven Victoria has been so key to this team throughout it. You know, they've managed to play such a team defense that they have been burnt by the lack of speed that Victoria has at the back, his lack of quickness, which is his Achilles heel, maybe literally in some cases. Who knows? It's getting older.
That's funny.
Danielle Henry's Achilles heel, as we all know, is that rush of blood that goes to his head from time to time.
That one moment every game Danielle plays, you're like, oh, damn, it's the moment. Anyways, we love you, Danielle. Here are the defenders available for Canada tonight. Outside of Steven Victoria, some of them are also called fullbacks in John Herdman's lineup. Cornelius, Scott Kennedy, Kamal Miller, Daniel Henry, Samuel Adekube, Christian Gutierrez, Alistair Johnston, Richie Larea. I wouldn't even be surprised to see a Gutierrez maybe play tonight. We'll see how John Herdman sets up his defense. There's a couple ways that they can go with it. Let's take a look at Salvador's lineup that they did play against the United States last week on Thursday, because I think they're going to set up a similar to this. They do play in a 4-3-3. So maybe Canada actually goes with the same type of formation they did play against the USA. It was successful. But in a team of El Salvador's caliber, you don't adjust too much. You play your own game, I believe. And I do believe Canada's 3-4-3 might come back this evening. Players to watch for El Salvador, Alex Roldan, famously, but he's not fully fit. It is the off-season for Major League Soccer players, and he hasn't been playing for a while because Seattle was eliminated quite early in the playoffs last year. So there's one thing. But when I look at this lineup, nothing really stands out outside of Alex Roldan. Hurtado might be their striker that's called upon to lead the line tonight. We'll see the decision of the El Salvador manager.
Yeah, look, you mentioned what Canada's going to match up to against El Salvador. You're absolutely right. They're not going to necessarily worry too much about what El Salvador is doing out there. I expect that, you know, unlike the Honduras game, where they gave up more of the ball than I think we expected because they got the lead fairly early, or the U.S. game where they went out with somewhat of the idea to give the ball up to hit them on the counter, and then they got the lead early too. In both cases, that saw Canada defend a great deal more than maybe we were used to earlier in the window. I anticipate that tonight they will have the ball a lot more. So that will be an adjustment for them to have to break down El Salvador. But the talent gap is there, and that's what really matters here most of all, I think, is the important thing to focus on. And to just go out and they play their game, I suspect that they can get this result. And look, they built themselves, I mentioned banana peel off the top, they built themselves such a gap that they can afford to slip up. The question now and what the motivation needs to stay with this in the same level of intensity the rest of the way through is because they need all the FIFA points they can get because it's time to start thinking about getting up in the FIFA rankings so you can get into a higher pot for the draw. It will take a lot for them to get into pot C or pot three, depending on how you put it. They're in pot four right now, for sure. They would need to win all four games to basically have a chance to move up. So that's the motivation. I'm sure that's all internal there. And you know, there'll be some other games in there that play some Nations League games, I think, in the September window. There's going to be a friendly in June. In fact, here's a fun one, guys. People watching the Brazil game last night said that on the Brazilian network television that they mentioned outright that they were going to book a friendly against Canada in June. So there's a little rumor for you. Which is,
and usually Brazil is not necessarily the best at keeping secrets, meaning if you want something to be shared with the world, just tell it to a Brazilian team.
Yeah, the Canadian and Brazilian Federation have a good relationship, and maybe we can ask Nick about this tomorrow.
I'm going to say maybe we can ask them to send up a few players and naturalize
them. Yeah, well, no, they do have a good relationship, and that as they played each other on the men's side more than you'd think, and they obviously play against the women's all the time, so I suspect that maybe some of those relationships might bear fruit for what would be a nice glamour friendly to cap off what's been a pretty good qualifying campaign in June if that does come to fruition. But more important things first is to get three more wins there, four more wins in this qualifying campaign.
Can you imagine? Canada wins out, goes undefeated in the entire octagonal. Oh, let's focus about tonight. And Duane mentioned Nick. It's because tomorrow on the show, we have Canada Soccer President Nick Bontis joining us. We'll be live at noon tomorrow. It'll be a great way to catch up with Canada Soccer's president and looking at this entire window and World Cup qualifying process all the way to today and see how mighty the journey has been. And of course, let's continue to just look at tonight's Canada versus El Salvador. I keep thinking Honduras and El Salvador, but that's because there's a common enemy here in this window. And I think that's where we can relate to things. Let's look at the statistics between Canada and Honduras last Thursday. Canada won 2-0. Canada did not get the whole brunt of the possession, and that's fine. That's kind of like a blueprint to Canada's counterattack. 41% possession, 59% against for Honduras. So Canada did not dominate some key stats. They dominate others. They were able to score when it was time, and it was score effect also, and they were controlling the midfield, which is what Canada does well. Let's have a look now at Honduras and El Salvador. Both games took place at Estadio Olimpico just a few days apart. There is a correlation to be made. 2-0 for El Salvador also. El Salvador had the same game plan. Keep the ball to Honduras. Let them basically destroy themselves with the own ball, which happened. 64% possession for Honduras, only 36% for El Salvador. El Salvador had more passes, well, very similar passes actually than Canada, six less, very similar number than Canada, but a little less foul, which means they're a little less conducive to stopping the momentum of midfielders, of the flow. And that's one of Canada's benefits. And that's where I think the game will be played tonight and won is in transition. Canada is better to transition the ball and keep the flow or stop that flow with players to do fouls. Stephen Eustachio might be available this evening. And if he plays, Mr. Foul Eustachio, in a good way, will be there to stop that flow, stop the momentum, transition into Canada's counterattack and momentum. And that's how Canada wins tonight.
Yeah, I mean, they win by playing their game. Now, Stephen Eustachio, we'll see whether he is ready. I don't think fitness will be an issue because he didn't have COVID in the... he had COVID what kind of way? He had COVID in the, you know, there were two lines in the stick kind of way. If you follow. So.
Asymptomatic is the words.
Yeah, so he should be fine if he is ready to go and out of the quarantine. Look, banana peel. That's the word of the day because there is no reason Canada should not win this game other than they let their guard down a little bit. So it really comes down to how they mentally approach the game and whether or not I think until they have the little star beside them on the table, they're going to remain focused entirely on getting that there. So I don't think this is going to be an issue, but I, you know, there's always a little anxiety before you go into one of these games.
Because we've been there before with only a draw or a win would qualify us. And still, yeah. Banana peel. Maybe that's the last demon to exercise is the banana peel factor and get rid of that anxiety because this crop of players never let us down when you think about it.
Yeah, well, look, I said this to people that were around me at the time that in both the Honduras games and the U.S. games in this window, I have not had the same level of angst and anxiety that I have in normal times. I mean, there's always a little bit, but it's not been nearly the same. And in fact, the last 20 minutes of that U.S. game, I would say to the people around me, now they're fine. There's no reason to believe they're going to crop this up. Now, it could happen because yes. It's soccer, and any one moment can cause a goal against. But it wasn't necessarily something that you felt ominous or on like that it was inevitable, like you have in the past. And I don't feel ominous about tonight's game. I have a bit of nerves about it, but I don't have, you know, a fear that they're going to blow it going into it. So, look, it's an opportunity to really prove more people wrong. I don't think you're proving anybody wrong now. You got people in Brazil talking about needing to book a friendly against you. Like, I mean, they made it. Like, you've got any outside observers are all, you know, outside of the crazy USMNT Twitter world, which is not a real world.
Which, hi, by the way, if you're watching us on the Twitter.
And the type of Twitter that I'm referring to is not watching us. They're yelling at each other is what they're doing. But, alas, hi guys, if you are. Other than that, everyone's given Canada full respect now. No one's thinking that this team isn't for real. This is a team that absolutely is, you know, better than the ranking suggests, and the ranking's not bad now. So there you go. And I expect them to go out and get a result tonight, get the win tonight. A draw, this is what I'm thinking of, you know, ultimately a draw would not be the worst end of the world by any means, but it would be disappointing, and that's telling on its own right now.
Here's a deep cut for you, Duane. Canada is so good that if Canada was a song, they would be in Rick D's top 40.
There you go.
I used to work Sunday mornings and Friday, Saturday mornings in arena in snack bars. And used to make a lot of coffee, a lot of toast. And I used to listen to Rick D's top 40. And I can sing you the jingle if you want to.
Now, well, if you'd like, but I don't know if the listeners need that.
Rick D's in a weekly top 40. Okay, thank you. I'll be here all week.
I got the betting odds in front of me if you're curious.
Let's go ahead.
All right, so Canada is a 180, so $1.80. So.
To win the World Cup?
No, that's to win tonight.
I'm just kidding.
Which would put Del Salvador at 490 as the opposite there if you want to bet on the win there because the draw's at 320. One of those crazy odds, and this it's creeped up during the show right now. Honduras right now are so much of an underdog. They're such a you-know-what.
That there's like that value of betting them because they're old. Well, Kyoto's joining the team. after publicly criticizing the Jar, they're like, okay, well, you want to criticize him? How about you come play for us this window too?
Yeah, they were 19. They went off at 19 this morning. They're at 21 right now. So the money's going more and more on the U.S. as it goes on. I don't know why anyone in their right mind would bet on the U.S. at 113. What are you risking that for? It went 13 cents on a dollar. But anyway.
Why would you do that? Well, yeah. Well, what's the goal line? Like, you should take with the Asian handicap, like a goal and a half or something, maybe it's worth it. But well, we're not here to break down. Betting on international soccer is like, wow.
$1,000, you'd make $138 left on the U.S. tonight. Like, that's not worth the risk, guys, if your batter's out there. But nonetheless, it's 21 might be worth a $5 bet just as a punt.
Yeah. Speaking of that, if you like college basketball, I'm going to record later today my college basketball getting ready for the madness of March. Pardieu. It's going to be a bi-weekly series. And we're going to look at some of the mid-majors conferences that are worthy to keep an eye on. And some of them are not even mid-majors anymore. Some of them are big teams. But that's when you actually have your upset of the 13, number 13 seeds that wins in the first round, which at the end of the day will make you win your bracket. And we'll break that down on Betting on Sports Podcast, which you can follow everywhere you find your favorite podcast. Dwayne and I will be right back after this short break. We'll break down USA's game against Honduras. We'll continue to look at the slate of game this evening in CONCACAF World Cup qualifying. We'll preview tomorrow's show on Soccer Today and more after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sports podcasting network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kev Larme joined by Duane Rollins as we look at CONCACAF's schedule this evening. We talked about Canada. Let's look at the United States because they are closing their window, of course. They're playing against Honduras tonight in Minnesota in what is going to be maybe the coldest men's national team soccer game ever played. Potentially of being minus 14, even colder in Celsius this evening, at least how it feels. This will be cold, and if you listen to ESPN FC and other places like that, they're mad at the U.S. Soccer Federation for putting the players in this circumstance. What do you think about the fact that they're playing in Minnesota against Honduras in frigid conditions?
I think that, and I say this as someone who went to Edmonton and was in Hamilton as well, and even enjoyed some of the hype around Ixteca and sort of the color around that. I think that maybe we've jumped the shark on this cold thing. Not that we can help it completely in terms of, especially up here, we can't. Like, I mean, we either play, the only option we'd have would be to play in BC place, which is not ideal for logistical reasons. So
Or the Olympic Stadium in Montreal or the SkyDome in Toronto. Those are the only covered stadium that would work, and there's no grass to be seen in any of them.
Yeah, so it's not ideal in Canada. If they're going to have home games up here, they're going to have some element of cold, too. And I think that they did with the January game by having it in Southern Ontario. It was probably their best chance, other than maybe Victoria. But then you're looking at a 10,000-seat stadium. So, right, like it's not necessarily ideal, but the U.S. doesn't have the excuse to play this game in Minnesota. They didn't have to do this. They're screwing Minnesota over by doing it. But they've been talking about going up there for years, and then they go up here in January. Like,
you got a great stadium. We're going to go in your stadium when you're going to be stuck to it after you sit there for 2 hours because it's so cold.
Yeah, and this is where I come down on this. It's like, you know, first off, I think I was joking a little bit about putting a punt on 21-1 against, you know, a terrible Honduras team. But you know what? It's not that much of a joke because that game is going to be completely ridiculous tonight. That it could be like ice and freezing and like rock hard ball. And God knows there could be like a weird bounce that happens and Honduras could pull it out of nothing without really deserving it. Like, it's not.
Also, what could happen is Honduras punts this game, barely plays, and just tries to stay warm.
Exactly. I mean, I'm not saying bet $100 on it, but bet 5. Anyway, but the, I bet on the under is 2.5. I don't know what the
that's not is there. Wow.
That I like.
This is a 1-0 game if I've ever seen one. Let's take a look at the table just to see what this is all for. U.S. are second in the octagonal table as we speak. They're behind Canada. They have 18 points. Honduras is dead last. And by far. They got 3 points in this entire tournament and not a win. That's because of 3 draws. They've scored 5 goals, conceded 19 for a minus 14 differential. 3 points. There's turmoil. Managers not necessarily gelling with his team. If you can read Spanish, go to see the Honduran national team media. It's a circus right now. And when I look at Honduras in minute, like, Honduras has already moved on in this window. They don't have, well, are they? Are they eliminated at this point? How many?
Yeah, they are eliminated.
I was going to say they don't have they don't have it eliminated next to the name. Well, they do. Honduras is not going to show up tonight. They're going to be there. Like, the light is going to be on, but no one's home.
You'd have to, El Salvador, you would trust more to step up after they've been eliminated than Honduras for the reasons you spoke of. And look, I maintain that one of the great failings of this call, like, again, there's no such thing as fair, COVID, all that. We said this 1,000 times, so it's not really CONCACAF's fault. But one of the big failings of this for Honduras, for Costa Rica, is that they went directly into this round. And that, I think, really took them out of their ability to grow momentum into it, because you're looking at teams like Panama and Canada, which have been able to keep playing on, even El Salvador, keep playing on from that and play at a little at a higher level. And those are, you know, Panama, El Salvador, Canada, the 3 teams Jonathan identified as playing to their ability of all the 3 teams that played the round to get into this. So that to me says a lot about this format. And I think that Honduras, it's a double whammy. Like, they were probably not going to qualify for this World Cup. They're on a down cycle. Like, for a small nation to qualify for every World Cup, that's not realistic. They've been to a couple in a row. Well, they missed the last one, but they were to 2 in a row before that. So it's not realistic for them to think that they can always get there. They're too small of a nation. But they didn't even have a chance to build some momentum by playing a semifinal round, by playing something earlier. And this is just, everything's just spinning out of control. And there's no positive at all in this. They have 3 draws. Like, that's their entire World Cup campaign is 3 draws. That's hard to take when you're a nation that's been to the World Cup in memory. So it's going to be a big recovery there for them. What they do tonight, you know, to show up in minus 26 Celsius weather with the wind chill tonight is a hard ask for anyone.
So what are the odds on the draw tonight? Like, that's what
7,
I want to know.
7.
So, okay. So you know what? That might not be a bad idea.
Yeah. I tell you what.
Like a nil-nil draw. Like, go exact score. If there's ever a nil-nil draw, it's this one.
I'd have to open it up more into the props. Just here's another. If you want to go Panama Honduras as a parlay, you could probably win about $500 on that.
I was going to say, what if you parlay? Like, yeah, exactly. Speaking of, here are the other games in CONCACAF this evening. We quickly mentioned them in the beginning of the show. Jamaica, Costa Rica. That one is at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, 10 p.m. Pacific. Jamaica needs a win, but, you know, quite frankly, it is over for the Reggae Boys. They are 7th with 7 points. 7 might be a lucky number, but it is not for the Reggae Boys this time around. It is for honor at this point, but, you know, they can play spoilers. Costa Rica does need a win to keep pace with Panama and hope that Mexico gets the job done at the Azteca tonight. If that happens, Costa Rica's on 16, Panama's still at 17, and then we have a battle, which would include the second and third place. If Costa Rica wins tonight, you actually have 4 teams battling for 3 spots.
Yeah, that absolutely could be the case for sure. Look, Costa Rica, Panama, the 3 teams below are not going to make the World Cup. Like, it's over but the crying. And, you know, if you're Jamaica, can be officially eliminated with a 1 draw by the, if the U.S. gets a point tonight, if Panama gets a point tonight, they'll be done. If they don't get a full 3 points, they'll be done. So it's not really likely that they're going to be able to get through there. Their magic number to be eliminated is 3, actually, just to looking at it carefully. So that's pretty much done there. And that's good news for Canada in that back window, because that means likely in the last round of qualifying that Jamaica will bring over domestic players. They won't bother bringing their players over from England, which will mean a weaker lineup there, which will be good there if you're really paranoid about Canada's chances.
That's true.
I mean, the fact that, look, quickly on Canada, I don't think that El Salvador, that Jamaica game is going to be in play now. If they don't clinch tonight, they're going to clinch in Costa Rica, I suspect. So at any rate, look, yeah, there's still a battle for that 2-3-4 position, though. And, you know, it doesn't really matter if you're second or third or first in this. The qualifying, you know, you don't get up in a higher pot, which is maybe a question you can debate. Nothing I've really thought of before, because we haven't been there before, but it kind of seems wrong that U.S. and Mexico be in a better pot than us at the World Cup draw. But alas, it is what it is, and the history had to play into it for the FIFA rankings. But nonetheless, there is a battle there, and that third, fourth obviously matters a great deal. And look, if you're Mexico, and that Panama-Mexican game.
Hey, yeah. It's big. It's bigger than you think.
Panama wins that game, or gets a draw, even.
Yeah.
The blank is real, is what we're saying.
If Mexico loses tonight, Mexico could finish fourth, and then Costa Rica could upset them. You never know. The next window is, you know, that's why we want Canada to get a job done tonight, because you don't want to be involved in there. You want to just step aside, let them fight it out, and just be ready to go to Qatar with the other two teams.
As much as our love of chaos is in play, what we really want tonight is for the U.S. and Mexico to win. Well, I don't care about the U.S., really. No offense, guys, but it doesn't really matter to us.
Honestly, even Mexico. Honestly, Canada wins, and then regardless of what happens, you're out of it, because you would have 25 points at that point. So
If Panama's at 17 to 25, then you're really looking at a very narrow, like, you don't have to do much more work from there. It would depend on other stuff. But at any rate, But if Mexico falls back into the pack, then that's going to be very interesting in that round. Tata, apparently, in Edmonton, walked in the dressing room after they lost 2-0 to Canada and offered to resign on the spot in front of the players. And the players said, don't. And that's why he stayed in his position. If they were to lose to Panama tonight at the Azteca,
he wouldn't ask the players. He would literally go to the players and say, ta-ta.
Yeah, it's going to be a much different situation. And look, when you look at the top three teams in this round, like, I don't think the table's lying. And I'm not being chauvinistic when I say that. Maybe you could go, as we've said all week, you could go top 50 players, and it's not going to be comparable when you get into Canada, when you get below 20 even, or 15 maybe. But when you're looking at the top 11, it's the best lineup, and they've been playing the best. They are the best team in CONCACAF right now. That is hard for me to, like, say without, like, thinking I'm pinching myself or wondering, you know, how I died and how this, you know, this heaven is exactly like Earth, I guess. Only Canada's good in it. Like, amazing.
Is this a multiverse? Did we change universe if we don't know?
Yeah, like, I mean, it's hard to understand that in my mind. And I just hope the dream, dream lasts till November, I hope. But
we're still waiting. Every single game we go to Central America, like, well, is this the game that the dream becomes a nightmare and that Canada loses by 5 goals? Tonight the one? And then we're like, well, it can't be. Even if the bookmakers are willing to take your money and barely give you any if Canada wins, well, it's because they think Canada's going to win.
Okay, guys, Canada's not going to win the World Cup, okay? Like, that does not seem likely. So they will lose eventually,
well,
but they're not going to...
Some people would tell you Greece in 2004 and all, but no, I agree with you. I don't even want to think about that because my heart can't take it.
Yeah, well, the point I'm making is that they are going to eventually lose, but they're not going to lose like they lost in the past. And that's a big, important distinction here. This is not a team that's going to be embarrassed or is going to go out with anything other than its top effort. They will eventually run into a team that will just be much more talented than them on all, like, forget the top 11. Like, they'll have Canada will have a couple players that they'll just isolate out and you know, our grit and determination won't quite get there. And they'll bow out. Maybe it's the round of 16 at a World Cup, and that would be a dream. Hell, maybe it's the quarterfinals, and that would be an absolute dream. I can't see it being much deeper than that, but, you know, Costa Rica got to a quarterfinal, so that's not completely discount the possibility.
Mexico got to a semifinal, and we were undefeated against Mexico this window. So, you know, CONCACAF does well at the World Cup level. let's be real. It's the last few World Cup. They've done well. And let's finish the show with this note. This is from Martin Bailey, friend of the show, fellow sports statistician. Canada clinches a spot for Qatar this evening if Mexico wins over Panama, Honduras wins over the USA, a draw or a loss of Costa Rica versus Jamaica, and a win against El Salvador. All these scenarios together, so these four separate events needs to happen for Canada to be able to qualify for Qatar before the clock strike midnight tonight.
Yeah, and the one that you're not going to likely see is Honduras over the U.S. And that's the one that you can kind of say, you know, the gods are on our sides if that one happens. But
that's true.
We mentioned the weather and everything else, and I think it's more important to look at what this will mean. With a Canada win tonight at 25, we'll likely set it up that 1 point will clinch.
So, you know, speaking of probabilities and statistics, when you think about it, there's a higher probability that Honduras wins tonight than there was of the Kansas City Chiefs to win a game in 13 seconds against the Buffalo Bills 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago. So at that point, the Bills were at 99.64% winning probability. So if you're a fan of math, you know that even sometimes point something actually comes true. So maybe Honduras tonight on the money line.
Yeah, why not? It's $21. I mean, just say goodbye to your money, likely, but it's fine. I wouldn't put a lot on it. This is turning into the betting for podcast show now, too, or betting for podcasts. That would be an interesting bet. It's bet on podcasts.
Betting on sports podcast. You can find that show hosted by myself, and we'll have guests eventually. And it's a work in progress. It's a different type of show. You can listen to it if you like. It's very numbers based. I use my analytical and statistical knowledge to bring you just talk about numbers, basically, when it comes to betting on sports. Before we say goodbye for today, Duane, and we'll see if the music is still working, it is the Five Rings Podcast. We'll be back soon because the Olympics have started today. Five Rings Podcast is Duane and I's first show together since 2014. This is our fifth Olympics together. And it is a Beijing type of day.
We missed the Beijing Summer Games the last time. If you're new to us, the Five Rings Podcast, as Kevin said, was our initial show. We started Soccer Today, which was called the Two Saltines Podcast at the time, which is why you'll still see that name in our feed some places. It started in March of 2014, so obviously February 2014 was when the Sochi Games happened, and that was our first podcast together. Now, if you want to go listen to the archives, Kevin probably will not like that because the sound quality is pretty bad, but it was a different time. It was a different time.
Nowadays, microphones and especially phones have upgraded a whole lot since then. But our production values also. And you can find that podcast wherever you find your favorite podcast. Just look for the Five Rings Podcast, available on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, and everywhere else you get your podcasts. I'm so old in the game that I still call it iTunes sometimes and like TuneIn Radio and stuff.
Yeah, iTunes. Yeah, that's how I remember it. Yeah, those original podcasts were done with a wine. Me balancing an iPad on a wine glass in my bedroom. So there you go. We're coming back with our traditional format. If you're new to us before, the gold, silver, bronze, poutine, and wood medals. Poutine being the best Canadian performance. Wood medal being the worst performance of the day,
or the moment, or whatever catches our attention. And this year we'll go podcast only. We did do graphics and videos last summer. Took a whole lot of time and. With my professional work this year and the other commitment at Soccer Today, we're going to do podcasts so we can actually commit to do Five Rings all the time without me spending 5 hours building the show.
Yeah, and I need to sleep sometimes too.
Exactly. We need to do
because of the summer, because the games would end in the edit at 8, and then Kevin would have to prepare the show. So we couldn't go on the air until about 11, and then I had like 2 hours to sleep. So it was pretty bad.
Exactly. So it will be fun. And also this time around, it's the Winter Games, which I have a fondness for Winter Games, maybe even more than Summer Games. So we can reminisce about Lillehammer, Aberville, and the ski ballet competition for a while. And we'll get to watch great competitions now. I'm going to keep an eye for Shalam Lang in the speed skating. He's going to retire after this summer. One of the best speed skaters in the history of the sport ever. And it's also an interesting aspect for the moguls for Canada with Kingsbury. Apparently, the conditions are very similar to what you would find in Mont-Saint-Sauveur, which means very high likelihood of a gold medal for Canada and maybe even two Canadian on the podium for the moguls competition. That's a little taste of what you can get on the 5X podcast.
Yeah, precisely. I would be very surprised if there's not at least one Canadian gold by the end of the weekend, because the slopestyle gold medal goes off on Sunday night, and heavy favorite there. So that Canada hockey tonight, if you're a hockey fan, the women start tonight at 11 o'clock p.m. on the CBC. We'll talk about that and more in the 5X podcast in the days ahead. Kevin, I'll let you wrap the show on that note.
And you can follow Duane on social media at 24th Minute, myself at Kev Laramie, and this show at Soccer Today SPN. Tomorrow at noon, join us on our Twitter feed at noon. We will have Canada Soccer President Nick Bontis joining us. It will be a great show. We'll talk about tonight's game. We'll talk about a whole bunch of topics in Canada Soccer. It will be a great pleasure to receive Canada Soccer President Nick Bontis on this show. Make sure you follow us and you subscribe to the podcast feed, to our YouTube page, and everywhere else you can find the show to not miss this wonderful episode that will be live and, of course, available on demand on podcast tomorrow. You can find the podcast version of this show everywhere you find your favorite podcast. YouTube page, youtube.com/sportspodcast. And click on that notification bell just so you know whenever we upload a new video. And as always, until next time, enjoy tonight's game. And maybe even more than one game, because there's one at 10 and there's one at 8. You can have a couple of screens going on in Concacaf World Cup qualifying. I know I am. And until tomorrow, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.